Okay, great. Well, thank you very much, Fotios, for agreeing, you know, to present these two chapters. I think it's a fantastic adding value to this, to having you with us and contributing to this. So thank you very much for your time. And it's over to you if you'd like to introduce yourself and then go ahead as you wish.
Sure. Thank you so much, Bachman. Thank you for inviting me here. So today we'll be talking about two chapters of Paul Goodwin's book on profit from your forecasting software, which is chapter 8, automation and choice, and chapter 9, judgmental interventions. And when Bachman first approached me to deliver this presentation, my first question is which book of Paul Goodwin are we presenting here? Because over the last few years, he has written three new books. One is called Forward, and this is essentially a popular science view of the forecasting field. The other one, which is more like for practitioners, is the one we're discussing today. But also recently, he also published another book called Something Doesn't Add Up, which is mostly related to the cons of statistics in popular science. So yeah, today we're talking about profit from your forecasting software, and in particular, these two chapters, automation and choice and judgmental interventions. And because Bachman asked me to introduce myself, I'm happy to do that, of course. My name is Fotios Petropoulos, and I'm associate professor at the University of Bath. I have been there now for 4 years, but before joining the University of Bath, I was at the Cardiff University, where Bachman is right now. So I was for 2 years there. And my background is on engineering, electrical and computer engineering, with a degree, doctoral degree in engineering from a National Technical University of Athens. And in particular for forecasting, I am spending my research time focusing on both statistical aspects of forecasting, but also just mental aspects. So I think me introducing these two chapters is somehow natural. So we'll start with chapter 8, which is about automation and choice. And Paul, in this chapter, discusses about the degree of automation that is offered by the support systems. And the first argument he makes is that even if there is automation within the systems, still judgment and judgmental choices are there to make some difference. And for example, when it comes to the quantity of the data history that you're going to carry so that you can fit your models and prepare your forecasts. And the quantity of the history is an important decision, because if you just restrict yourself in short histories, then maybe some methods are not available for you to fit your models. So the data that you have in your hands essentially give you access to more or less forecasting methods. Also, there are some inherent restrictions from some software when it comes to the amount of data that they carry over. For example, SAP APO, they carry 3 years of monthly data, and they simply disregard the past history of data. Disregarding the past history of data is, of course, questionable by itself, because sometimes there is something there that the methods can use to make better predictions or better estimation of the uncertainty. Another aspect that requires judgment in the automation aspect is what are we asking for our methods, and how sophisticated our methods would like to be? Because we have to find a balance there. If we go for very complex methods, then potentially we require to have more data available, or if we have methods that require exogenous variables, then we have to collect data for these predictors as well. And also, sometimes complex methods may lack credibility and trust among practitioners because they don't understand them, and sometimes they are considered as black boxes. At the same time, though, automation is welcome because, first of all, in many practical cases, you have to deal with thousands of forecasts to produce. imagine in a retailer setting, a standard retailer may have several tens of thousands of different SKUs within a store, and then you have to multiply by the number of stores, by the number of locations, regions, and so on and so forth. And you have to produce forecasts for every of these levels. So in a sense, doing all of this judgmentally, selecting one by one the models, the parameters, etc., is something that it simply cannot be done. And some systems, some current software, are good to the dimension that they can select an appropriate method, but also they can give reasonings why they did select this method over other methods, or they can even select a suitable subset of predictors from a larger set of predictors. Also, current software are also able to pre-process the data automatically. For example, they are able to remove outliers if outliers exist, or potentially to cut the appropriate amount of history that we need in order to not take into account data that are old enough where pattern changes or structural changes have been observed and these data are not relevant anymore. And as I said, automation might be the only choice if you are dealing with thousands and thousands of products. Now, I would like to make here a comment about pre-processing data and outliers, and this is a personal observation that I have from outliers, removal of outliers, and forecasting in particular. Removing outliers from some time series data, potentially it will lead to better estimation of the point forecast, the mean estimate. But at the same time, because we are removing the outliers, might not be in a position to estimate very well the associated uncertainty of around the forecasts. So you might be doing better in point forecast accuracy, but you might be doing worse in estimating predictions intervals, for example. So how much past data should we carry over? I think it really depends on what methods we'd like to apply. And if we are to discard all data, then we should discard this based on some rules, only discard when the past observations are not relevant anymore. Remember that some methods, like exponential smoothing methods, they are built in a way that exponentially decline the way that they consider the past observations. So essentially, if the data are not relevant enough, then the estimation of the smoothing parameters works in a way that essentially past data are discarded automatically. And given that data storage nowadays is so cheap, there's no real argument in why not keeping all the data, and whenever you have a structural break, then potentially consider the only more relevant data. Now, in some cases, you may have very short histories or even no histories at all. For example, when you have a new product with only a couple of weeks of sales, or even if you have a new product for which you don't have any reported sales at all. Even in these cases, you might be able to produce forecasts by considering the sales of analogous products. So two factors essentially will depend on our selection of how many data we'd like to have for our models. And these factors are the complexity of the models. The more complex the model, the more data we need. And complexity here is measured in terms of parameters. And the second aspect refers to the randomness. In respect to the number of parameters, in this table, which is taken from the book, you can see the minimum number of data points that are strictly technically required to fit some models. For example, for simple exponential smoothing, you need at least 3 data points to fit a model. Then you have, of course, to estimate the alpha smoothing parameter and the initial level. However, some software have even further restrictions. So for example, on top of my head, I think that ETS for R, ETS function of the forecast packet for R, requires more than 5 data points to fit a whole method. It might be around 7 or 8, but I don't think it's just 5. So even if this table refers to the minimum number of data points that are technically required to fit models, in some cases, we should have more data. If we don't have enough data points, then our estimation of uncertainty will be not as good. We see here two examples of the effects of randomness in estimating a regression line in this case. On the left graph here, we have three data points and we fit the regression line, and we assume here, for the sake of the example, that this fit regression line is a good approximation of the reality. In this case, you can see that the forecast errors, the residuals essentially, are quite small, so the uncertainty in this case is small, so we are not affected by the lack of data points. But it could be the case, like in the right graph here, that given our fit, given data points, and the fit here is the dashed line that you can see, given the fit, it might be the case that the fit is not representative to what actually happens in reality, and the reality here is represented by the solid line, and you can see that the fitted line gives a negative trend, whereas the actual data have a positive trend, and this is because the randomness in this data is very high. So if we have more randomness in our data, ideally we'd like to have more data points to fit our models. And Paul argues that if we focus on the standard calculation of the prediction intervals, essentially the width of the interval is proportional to the square root of the number of observations, which means if we increase our sample size four times, then we decrease our prediction intervals. We halve our prediction intervals, we decrease them by two. Of course, feel free to interrupt me if you have any comments or questions.
Yeah, Fotios, maybe in the discussion with NHS people, one thing they mention all the time is the policies are changing in NHS quite a lot. And this question of how much data they should use is actually is very relevant. And I think what they do really is they just ignore the older data because they believe, you know, the new policy is quite different from the previous policy, and the behaviors and admissions and things are quite different. So what do you think about? Do you think that is something they could model, because they, you know, interventions are quite often in NHS? Do you think that's something they should model, or is it just something they could ignore?
When you talk about interventions here, you mean just mental interventions or something else?
No. It's like, for example, they introduce a new policy or they introduce a new program. This is what they call the intervention program or something like that. And that, you know, that may change the behavior of patients going to a service, or they may also change the service itself, the way they deliver it or the thing like that.
I think that this kind of intervention you're talking about, they're not a new thing. Mm-hmm. It's a continuous thing that happens in NHS, and presumably you could somehow model it in your data. I mean, if you do have track of the interventions of the past, you could see how these interventions potentially impact upward or downwards, I don't know, admissions or demand for drugs or whatever they affect. I don't think just describing because we have a new intervention or a new policy is a good argument, because then you simply rely on judgmental forecasts effectively. So the other way to do it would be, you know, not to rely on judgmental forecasts per se, but to still use your whatever data you have and produce a statistical forecast, either univariate or multivariate, and then adjust this forecast based on the evidence of the new interventions. And we'll discuss about this in chapter 9 today. So I think learning from your data is important. Even if you decide to discard them, from a modeling perspective, I think you should use them to learn how past interventions affected your sales or the demand, and then use these insights towards the new situation, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Right. So then Paul advocates a section of this chapter in discussing about if complex methods are better than simpler methods or not. And the argument is complexity versus simplicity is a long-standing argument in the forecasting literature, with several of the forecasting competitions of Mavrilakis suggesting that simple methods are better, up until the later ones where some more complex methods achieved to outperform the simpler methods. So the answer here is not black and white. It depends. Sometimes complex methods can be better, but sometimes simpler methods could be good enough. So complex methods are better in capturing the patterns in the data, nonlinear patterns, but also maybe this comes with attempt to overfit to the data. So whatever we choose, complex or simple, we should be doing out-of-sample evaluation, not just see how well the model fits the in-sample data, but also use the model to make extrapolations, to make predictions on unseen data. Armstrong and Green are two of the supporters of the simple methods, and they did a meta-analysis and they showed that the complex methods do not necessarily add and are useful. However, we should not really discard complex methods altogether, because if you have, let's say, call center data, daily arrivals at a call center, or if you would like to model electricity demand, then in these cases, you would like to have models that are able to handle multiple seasonal cycles. You would like to have a simple exponential smoothing model, because it wouldn't be good enough. So I think it's about finding the correct balance within the situation you are into, case by case, and always explore if a more complex method will add value. And here, add value is, in my opinion, both in terms of performance, forecasting accuracy, but it's also in terms of additional computational cost. Because complex methods will require more data and more time to compute. So, given all of this now, when it is best to automate and when it's best to not automate? So when we have a large number of forecasts to be produced, and as I say, in a retail setting, that might be several tens of thousands of forecasts, then automation should be the rule, and handling of management should be the exception in these cases. Otherwise, it would require a lot of human resource employee time to deal with just other forecasting. Fortunately, nowadays systems have monitoring control systems which allow us to essentially report flags if something is going wrong with a product. And this also is related to what is called the tracking signal, which essentially measures over time the propensity of a model to be biased, to be always underperforming, under forecasting or over forecasting, which might require some manual interventions. In practice, what is happening here is that practitioners, demand managers, will not change the model or the parameters as long as there is a tracking signal that tells them to do otherwise. And if it does not otherwise, they might adjust a parameter, a smoothing parameter, or they might select a different model altogether. When the system is transparent about the automated choices, for example, I selected this method because I saw that data are not stationary, so I applied differencing, and also I saw some autocorrelation, so I chose an AR1 term there. So if the system is transparent behind the reasons that why a method is selected, then the probability of this method being accepted is higher. And at the same time, it might be the case that when we just mentally select or models or parameters, or we just mentally forecast, sometimes we tend to confuse the signal with the noise. Right. Another good point about automation is the avoidance of judgmental forecasting by the backdoor. And here, Paul has an excellent example, which I present in the next slide. In essence, here we talk about system manipulation. So what we're doing now, we use the system to produce statistical forecasts, but there will be a set of forecasts that will be more acceptable to the senior manager team. So this, for example, could be the use of exponential smooth methods, but with just mental manually selected parameters that essentially they fit the scope of political pressure. Still, despite the fact that these forecasts are just mentally manipulated, still managers are calling these forecasts computer system forecasts. And if something goes wrong, they don't blame the interventions, they blame the system. For example, imagine this case here where you have in the top left panel, you have with blue the sales and with black the forecasts. And these are the automated forecasts from exponential smoothing. And you can see the line going up and down following the data. The problem here is that in the last period of demand, the demand was quite high. So our forecast for the next period is not as high. And this might create some controversies here. So we have a demand manager playing with the system, manipulating the system, and they decide to change the smoothing parameter, in this case, to increase the smoothing parameter so that the forecasts are more reactive to the recent changes. So the manager gets the top right graph on the screen here, but you can see here that we have so many zigzags, so many ups and downs, and so many noise in the forecasts. So the managers consider that this forecast might not be accepted as reliable because it has so much uncertainty around it. So then the manager says, okay, I will fit another model. I will fit a regression model based on time as trend. And this, it will give him the bottom left graph here. But this graph is even more problematic because the trend here is just a bit downwards and it doesn't fit with the short-term movement of the sales in the last few weeks. So the manager finds the golden solution here and he says, okay, I will do a regression model, but only on the last few weeks available. And this is the bottom right graph here. So everything looks good because the graph goes up and the forecast for the next period also looks good. So that's the forecast that they would put forward. Of course, this is not a statistical forecast anymore in this case. It has been produced from the system, but after just mental manipulation. Right. Right. I think I covered more or less the chapter 8 of my course book, according to my notes here. So we'll go now to the next chapter, which is just mental interventions. Before I continue, maybe you have any comments or questions you would like to.
Maybe what I have a question for you is in terms of, the last thing you mentioned about, managers or maybe analysts changing the parameters in the model and then, fit the model, etc. How often you see this in practice? Is it something people they do often in, for example, in supply chain? Because the thing, I see here with NHS Wales or with Welsh Ambulance, they don't do such a thing. For example, they just use the statistical model and then later they may just make some adjustment. So I was wondering how often, people in other domains, they do this.
Paul described a couple of anecdotes in his book that he saw practitioners in companies doing that kind of manipulation. And from my personal perspective, we shouldn't assume that they don't do that, especially when the software mostly all the software available gives you the option to do that. So there is the option to change the smoothing parameter, so they might do that. And as we will talk now in the next chapter, sometimes, you know, practitioners do these small changes either on the forecast directly on the system's parameters for no good reason, but because they want to justify their time being forecasters potentially. I don't have evidence from a published paper if this is happening and how often this is happening, but coincidentally, I will be presenting about the effectiveness of chest metal parameter selection for simple exponential smoothing in a couple of hours in ICER. Let's proceed now with chapter number 9, which is on judgmental interventions and when these interventions are appropriate and when they're not appropriate. Right. So, first of all, I would like to mention that judgment is everywhere in the forecasting process. And it's not only about selecting the hyperparameters, how much data we'd like to use for our fitness models, or what measures, what KPIs we're going to use for evaluation, or even how far ahead we're going to produce forecasts for, but also judgment is used to produce judgmental forecasts directly, or even to judgmentally select a forecast method, or even to define a set of models, or even to parameterize a model. The arrows here with dashed lines are the ones that have been explored less in the literature. What is the effect of judgment on that? But here, what we'll discuss about is the last step here of the forecasting process, which is the finalizing of forecasts. And here I'm referring to that we have a statistical forecast, and then the manager comes and they adjust the forecasts upwards or downwards. And this essentially is called judgmental intervention or judgmental adjustment. So evidence says that this is happening very, very often. Usually more than 60%, in some cases as often as 90%. Files and Goodwin and others have published a paper in 2009, which is very highly cited actually, and provides evidence from four or five companies that this is happening. On the same year, Francis and Legester published another paper on pharmaceutical data, and they also demonstrated that adjustments are extremely common there as well. And why managers adjust statistically produced forecasts? First of all, because sometimes computer-based forecasts are not politically welcome and they are not trusted. Second of all, again, as I said, they do just very small interventions. So for example, changing a number from 2,450 to 2,452, not a major change, just a very minor change, because otherwise it would seem that they're not doing their job. And other times, there is a confusion between what is the target and what is the plan and what is the forecast. So forecast should be our best estimation of what's going to happen given the data or given our knowledge. But this is not the target and this is not the plan. However, sometimes when people produce forecasts, let's say the forecast that's produced is 100, then people add up some forecast, so they adjust it to 130 or 140, so that the replenishment and safety stock, et cetera, et cetera, is occurring in a way that is safe for the environment, so don't have low customer levels. But here, we need to distinguish between what is forecast and what is target and what is the plan. A fourth reason why people adjust forecasts is because they think that they can do better than the system itself. And sometimes they can. If they have knowledge that the system does not have, sometimes they might be able to improve forecasts. But more often than not, they will not be able to improve forecasts because of psychological biases. So we will explore some of these psychological biases now. The first bias is the confusion of noise with patterns. We as humans like to find patterns in everything. So we We don't like straight line forecasts, such as the one produced by simple frontier smoothing. We don't like the fact that statistical forecasts filter out the randomness, because when the randomness is filtered out and the forecast is smooth, then we believe that this randomness, the zigzag of the actuals, is not taken into account. We as humans are seeking patterns everywhere. And when we see a pattern, we think that the computer has missed that pattern, and we think that we are better than the computer. But sometimes these patterns are illusory. They're not real patterns there. The other thing that affects us here is that we are trying to create stories around small times, small movements around the data. So if the data go up or down, we are trying to say, oh, we hired this new person who is actually very good in sales and marketing, so that's why the sales of the last month or last week increased. So we're trying to invent stories and explain every little movement, even if these stories are not relevant. In particular to illusory patterns, and we as humans are pattern-seeking animals. Paul describes in his book that we look at the clouds and we see animals upon the clouds. I have another example here of that, an example that I found this morning on Twitter. On the right-hand side, you can see the Turkish lira, how it goes up and down, and on the left-hand side, of course, you can see Donald Trump. You can see how well Donald Trump's profile fits the movement of the lira. Of course, you can use this as illusory pattern to predict how the Turkish lira will progress over the next few days if you are fooled, if you wish, by randomness and you start seeking patterns everywhere. So another psychological bias that affects judgmental forecasts is the recency bias. And also this goes together with our need to discard past information as irrelevant. The NHS people that Bachmann was saying, they say, oh, back then it was different because now we have this new policy, this new intervention, and now things will be different. Will they, though? Do we have actually evidence for that they will be different? We tend to focus on the very last movement of the time series. And sometimes we just get two data points and we draw a regression line based on the data points, and let's say we say that, oh, over the last 3 months, the criminality rate for this region has increased, but we only based our observation on two data points. We don't even know if the increase is statistically significant or not. We overreact in recent movements, and also we pay extra attention to high-profile events, for example, a terrorist attack, and we disregard the base rates. And an excellent example here is how Americans avoid taking flights after the 9/11 incident. And everybody was using their cars more often, which of course is a much less safer commute means than the plane itself, which of course increased a lot the deaths and the numbers of deaths. So the thing is that these high-profile events stick in our memory for the better or for the worse. And for example, earthquake, right? Or terrorist attack. And we disregard the everyday reality. We disregard what we call the base rate. And because of this one very high-profile event, which might not be relevant, we think that everything will be exactly the same as this one high-profile event. Another psychological bias that influences us is the so-called hindsight bias, and this bias essentially refers to our thinking of being experts and knowing everything after the event has happened. For example, 4 years ago, Trump was elected as a president. That was a very surprising outcome of the American presidential election. But a month or two after it happened, every one of us potentially were thinking, oh, I have predicted that. I knew that this was going to happen. But possibly a week before the election, everybody was betting for Hillary. The same is true for the Brexit referendum result. And before it happened, everybody was confident, of course, that everybody will stay, will vote remain. But after it happened, everybody thought, I knew it all along. And this illusion of expertise drives managers to think that they are better than the system, because even if an error, a forecast error is made for the next period, they can justify it with hindsight bias, and they will think that the world is more predictable than it actually is. So we as humans tend to underestimate the uncertainty, and we don't tend to learn from past forecast errors. In fact, sometimes we just disregard them, and we just believe that, you know, we are better than the system, and we just go with our forecasts. A fourth psychological bias here is optimist bias, and of course we are optimistic by nature, and there are some studies that suggest that being optimistic versus pessimistic, it might also be good for your health. However, being optimistic in judgment interventions means that more often than not, you will adjust upwards than downwards. And sometimes you will adjust too high upwards so that the adjustment is way too large, that effectively, even if an upwards adjustment was needed, your adjustment, because it will be too high, will essentially decrease the forecast accuracy. So we also tend to pay selective attention to information that will reinforce our biased view. For example, if we are a sales manager and we would be, let's say, politically motivated to produce a high sales forecast, then we select to hear only evidence that support our view of high sales, and we discard evidence of the opposite. Again, here we have to remember the base rates, and we have to think that this time is not different necessarily. This time is not necessarily unique. This new product will not necessarily succeed, because the base rate says that the majority of the new products do not succeed. So, given the evidence from the psychological literature, how can we restrict our judgmental interventions? So one way to do that is to focus, first of all, on large adjustments. And the empirical evidence suggests that large adjustments are better than small adjustments. Now, what is large here? Possibly it changes from case to case, but a large adjustment here possibly is an adjustment that is higher than your average forecast error. So large adjustment shows commitment, because if you actually do a large adjustment, you don't want to look foolish in your fellow demand planners. So large adjustment shows commitment and shows skin in the game, in Taleb's words. So usually you will commit to such an adjustment if you have reliable information based on promotions, price changes, etc., etc. But you also have to be careful that this type of information has not been taken into account by the automatic forecasting system. Otherwise, you will be accounting for these events twice. Another thing is to restrict the interventions is to focus on what actually matters. And if you have multiple SKUs, multiple products to make interventions on, potentially what matters is the more important, the most important of these products. You can consider a Pareto classification of your products on ABC importance. A are the more important items, they usually represent 10% of your items that generate 70% of the revenues. Then you have the B items, which are usually 20% that generate 20% of the revenue. And then you have the C items, which are less important. They represent 70% of your items, but they only bring in 10% of the revenues. So here, potentially, you would like to focus on the 10% A items, the more important, the most important items. And at the same time, there might be the case that you would like to differentiate based on the forecast ability. And whatever has higher forecast ability, maybe it's better to leave it for automatic forecast selection and forecast production. Whereas when the forecast ability is low, then maybe more managerial attention is needed. So all in all, focus on what matters. In order to make our interventions more effective, Paul Goodwin discusses several techniques here. One of the first techniques is called divide and conquer, or if you wish, forecasting by decomposition. And the argument here is that the world is complex and sometimes is challenging and difficult to make decisions based on multiple factors, on multiple attributes. So if, for example, you would like to adjust your forecast, your sales forecast for the next period, and you know that you have a promotion going on in the next period, but also the government introduced 5% tax on that product category. But at the same time, though, market research is positive and the weather is looking good. So you have several attributes there to consider, and maybe one way to do it is to split the problem in smaller parts, more manageable parts, and try to avoid to produce a holistic raw judgment, but try to estimate the effect of each thing that is happening separately, and try to also account for interaction events, interaction effects, if possible. A key part here is that you'd like to document your rationale for the adjusted forecast, and this will allow tractability, and essentially you can go back and check how your forecast looked like based on the conditions and maybe take this into account for future forecasts, but also will allow people making further adjustments or enhancements on your forecasts if needed. Another way to make effective interventions is the use of analogies. And let's say you have a special event happening. Let's say you have a product, and you have this product, let's say, has quite a lot of sales history, but you apply a new type of promotion on this product, one that has not been applied before on this product. But it might be the case that this promotion has been applied on other products. So you might want to gather analogous situations and try to recall similar cases and as many cases as possible, not only the latest case possible, so that you avoid the recency bias. Take an inside and outside also view what happened to other companies in similar situations. Record what has happened in past cases, in past analogous cases, but also record the degree of similarity of each one of these cases with the current case. And based on this, you can create a weighted forecast, a weighted forecast based on previous outcomes, but also based on similarity. Another technique that makes our interventions effective is to counteract optimist bias, and there are a few things here to consider. One thing is to track and monitor the bias. You can use a KPI that is suitable for bias, such as mean error or mean percentage error, and check if you are consistently under forecasting or over forecasting. If that's the case, a technique here is called mechanical adjustment of your final forecast, and essentially, instead of taking in full the judgmental intervention, the intervention is essentially decreased so that the bias is filtered out. However, we have to keep in mind that bias tendencies might change over time, so maybe this mechanical adjustment needs to be revised. And also, it might be the case that because people will know that this mechanical adjustment takes place, they might make the interventions higher or lower, or change their style to essentially overrule the mechanical adjustment that's going to happen afterwards. Another technique to counteract for optimist bias is a devil's advocate. So you can have a roundtable discussion, and if some people say that our forecasts, our sales look very positive because of this and this and that reason, then you have a couple of people presenting arguments and questions and essentially challenging the demand planners why that would be the case. And also remember to include inside and outside view and pay attention to the base rate. Then Paul discusses about the power of the crowds, and it doesn't have to be large crowds here. Even small crowds are very good in improving our forecasting accuracy. Now, we have to be careful here when we gather people in a room. We have to be careful of some problems of groupthink, such as groupthink or such as dominating views. Would like all views to be heard equally and not some of them to be essentially take more weight into the decision making. So we need to find structured ways to elicit knowledge from groups of people. And two such ways are Delph method and prediction markets. In Delph method, what we do, we ask from participants to give us forecast judgments anonymously. And we collect these judgments, we summarize them, and we present them back to the group as a feedback, and then we ask them to readjust them, etc., etc. And this happens a few times. Now, it's not very dynamic in the sense that the members of the group between them, they don't exchange any views, and there is also not much skin in the game. So there is not really incentive in producing accurate forecasts on an individual basis. However, empirically speaking, Delph method has shown to produce good forecasts. Another alternative here would be to do something that's called prediction markets. And essentially, it works like stock market, and you buy a share if you think that the sales will be higher than the expected sales, or you say if you think the opposite. This is financially incentivized essentially, but it has some, of course, negative effects, such as cascading effects. If people start selling shares like the stock market, then it might be a crash, which might not be representative of the reality. And once again, there is no exchange of reasonings and arguments. Finally, to make our interventions effective, Paul suggests that we record the rationale behind interventions, behind adjustments, and essentially this would discourage by making adjustments just to make adjustments, but will also allow us to look back and check if our adjustments were made well and if the reasoning was also well. Most software systems nowadays, they offer a free-from-text facility to record the reasoning for such adjustments, even if checkboxes or drop-down lists could be more effective, as long as we avoid an option that's called NGR. And this is an anecdote from my experience in Canada, when a company had a drop-down list to record rationale for the adjustments, and one of the options in dropdown is the NGR option. And the vast majority of the adjustments had NGR as rationale. And when somebody asked the demand planners what NGR stands for, the reply was no good reason. So they were essentially making adjustments for no good reason. So as long as your adjustment is justified and is for good reason, and is well documented, I think it will make a difference. Finally, in this chapter number 9, Paul discusses about the power of combinations, and here he discusses about combinations of format, or statistical, if you wish, statistically produced forecasts with judgmental forecasts. And he discusses that the statistical algorithms and humans have complementary strengths and weaknesses, and the humans, in one hand, have psychological biases, are inconsistent, but they are very easy to adapt and very flexible, whereas algorithms are robust and powerful. They can produce forecasts for thousands of series very fast, but are not as flexible. So one solution here would be to produce forecasts with statistical methods and judgment independently, and then combine them together. And this has been proved to be a very beneficial strategy in forecasting, especially when forecasts are diverse. And in this case, they will be diverse because they will come from statistical data point evidence and also judgment. However, we have also to take care, because still humans might produce forecasts such that they counteract mechanical corrections, such as combinations or such as adjustments to based on biases. So they might produce an even higher or even lower judgmental forecast, so that effectively they give more weight to their own forecast. And I would also like to say that I have written a review for this book on the Foresight International Journal of Applied Forecasting, which is a journal for practitioners. And this review was published 2 years ago in issue 51. So if you'd like to read my overall opinion about the book, you can also check this review out. Otherwise, that was my presentation, and thank you so much for listening.
Okay, thank you so much, Fotios. I don't know if anyone has a question. You can. Yeah, Shishwan.
Hi, Fotios. Thank you very much for your talk. I do have a question about combining judgmental forecasting with systematic forecasting. So you mentioned that sometimes we can observe the bells over time, and then we can use judgmental adjustment to minimize the bells. So I was wondering, why not just build in this adjustment mechanism into the system? So for example, you can monitor the bells, out of sample bells, and if the system detects, okay, there is some kind of always under forecasting or over forecasting, then your system automatically make this kind of adjustment. For example, you can try to identify the gap, and then over the time your system will automatically minimize the gap. So my question is, just make this kind of some part of the human judgmental forecasting into the built-in system.
I think what you're discussing here about is that we are indeed able, using some statistical methods, like methods that take predictors into account, to somehow account for the effect of promotions or price changes, etc., etc., from a statistical point of view, which to a degree makes the adjustments less of a need than they actually are. However, I would like to say here that adjustments are not only happening because we have information that the systems does not have. Sometimes adjustments are happening for their own reasons that I present on this slide here. In fact, a system that wouldn't allow for the model adjustments at all, it might not be welcome from a practitioner point of view. I'm not saying that this is correct. I'm saying that this is the case. So yes, even if we could, given that we have enough data, we could potentially model the effect of a promotion or a particular type of promotion either using some type of regression models or even pooled regression models across different SKUs, if this type of motion has been applied to other SKUs. Still, sometimes adjustments are made. Now, there are cases where building in predictors in our models, it might not be as easy as it sounds, because some of the variables that might affect our demand might not be easy to forecast. For example, in some cases, consider that you might want to add as a predictor the GDP, the gross domestic product. Okay? But now the question becomes, if you would like to forecast, let's say, your sales, you will first have to forecast the GDP. So essentially, the problem of forecasting then cascades to forecasting another variable and another variable and another variable. But that's not the case, of course, when it comes to what we can control. We can control promotions, we can control the price of the products, we can control these kind of things. And what we can control, we can easily have access to what's going to happen in the future, because we will know if we want to run a promotion or not. But not all the predictors are as easily forecastable as it seems like. So the incorporation of an economic decline, for example, in the forecasts, is not as easy. Or let me give a recent example now. What was the impact of coronavirus on the demand for pasta late February, early March in UK? Was that something that could be captured by the model? Because we didn't have any past instances on that. Or was that something that could actually be supported by just metal intervention?
Yeah, thank you very much for your explanation. Yeah, my idea is, sorry, I didn't make it clear just now. My idea is just build in the forecasting error. For example, in the case of coronavirus, and then you over time, you make forecast by the system, and then you can observe that you always under forecast the coronavirus cases, and then you observe this under forecasting, and then you can use the forecasting error to adjust your system. So you build in the forecasting error maybe in the last few periods, and then make it useful for the system.
Mm-hmm. And this is exactly one of the ways here that we can make interventions more effective, essentially by mechanically adjusting based on the past forecast errors of such interventions. And this could be for adjusting the bias in the forecasts or any other kind of adjustment. If, again, I understand your question correctly here.
Yeah. I think that's the case. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well,
maybe I have a question if you...
Do you still have time?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, just a short question. Yeah, thank you, Professor Fotios, for your presentation. You talked about analogy between products when we don't have enough past data. I think in chapter 8, you talked about this quickly. My question is, how do practitioners find analogy within products? Do they do this in a judgmental way or in a statistical way, for example, by clustering or by other means?
I think it's both. Definitely the literature has demonstrated both. There is something that's called structured analogies, which is a judgmental forecasting method, which again, we have a facilitator and we have a group of experts, and the facilitator asks the experts to recall as many analogies as possible and also to put down the outcome of these analogies. And then the facilitator collects the analogies and produces a weighted forecast. So one way to do it is that. But it can definitely be done by techniques such as clustering. You can cluster based on number of variables, which can include the product characteristics from a category to price to whatever you can imagine, but also, you know, other types of research has focused on simply finding similar histories of data. So no matter where the data come from, for example, you may be forecasting a chocolate bar, but you get data from, sales of cars. Okay, and if the data appear to be the same, that might be a good similarity. Of course, you don't really focus on just two or three similar cases. You try to find as many similar profiles as possible and then produce an average forecast. So yeah, both cases, both testamental cases and statistical cases for finding these analogies work.
Okay, thank you.
Fotios, maybe I have two very quick questions if you have time. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I think that the first question is about more like long range forecasting. And again, of course, it depends when you talk about long range forecasting. It depends on the context and then how large the thing is. But if you look at actually a global health sector in particular, actually they do a lot of long range forecasting. Let's say forecast for next 5 years. In particular way, when they want to introduce a new product like a vaccine, this is the sort of thing they always need. Do you think any statistical method could be helpful in this kind of situation, or it could be just a purely a judgmental approach, or maybe just a combination of this kind of thing?
I think in this case, you would be more comfortable going with scenarios. So some scenarios could be based on statistically extrapolating observed data patterns, but other scenarios could be based on, you know, worst and best case scenarios of what's going to happen. And I think then taking decisions based on which one of these scenarios, it might be the best way forward. So there, I cannot see that there would be a singular type of decision, type of action, but there would be an if case situation. If this is happening, then we should go for that. If this is happening, then we should go for that. But I might be wrong. I'm not very into long range and strategic forecasting. I have not done much in that. So maybe I'm not the most appropriate person to reply to this question. But my understanding is that scenario planning would be your best case here.
Do you think, I mean, in general, do you think we have enough literature in that area?
Not necessarily in IJF, in the International General Forecasting, but definitely there is some literature there on technological forecasting and social change generally.
Okay.
Yeah, I think there you will find more stuff.
Actually, the journal, I think Spiros Makradakis published it in 1950 or 1960.
Long-range planning.
Yes. Long-range planning, yeah. And it was really interesting. And that paper is really nice as well. Well, it is just about the principles of forecasting, but it's really well written.
Yeah. Another thing you could have a look at potentially is for the people who are on the call and don't know about it, Bachmann, I, and 72 other people recently finished a paper on forecasting theory and practice. And within that paper, there are a few sections that essentially present Bass models and diffusion models and forecasting with S-curves and stuff like that. And they talk about competition in markets and these kind of forces. So this could also be relevant for a more long-term forecasting than we actually do for an operational point of view.
Yeah, okay, thanks. So my final question was about, well, as you say, this is quite often, you know, the people in practice, they make changes, they take the statistical forecast and then adjust it. So my question more was about the forecasting support system. Do you know any forecasting support system that they take this into account systematically? So it means, you know, each time they make a judgment, they provide the feedback, and then somehow this feedback is analyzed, and then they feedback again to the, you know, next time they want to adjust. Is there any forecasting support system they are doing this?
I think that there are. I would I will talk about a case that I'm definitely sure of, and this is a case of a company in Canada. The company is called Thinkhead, and they had a product called Forecasting Guardian, and they definitely do that with the software. So they track a lot based on past performance, but also based on ABC XYZ analysis. And then they essentially flag the cases, the products that the manager should pay attention on based on all of these factors. So yeah, there are, then most possibly there are other software that they do that. So yeah, well, definitely R is not doing that.
That was interesting. It was something came to my mind then. Of course, now with more like development things around dashboards, yeah, and shiny and things like that.
Yes, exactly. This company that I am referring to, PTHead, exactly has developed a dashboard to do this kind of thing. Whereas in R, you can definitely find the underlying methods for this. You can definitely find something like tracking signals or tricks method for monitoring these kind of errors, but putting them together and presenting them in a nice dashboard interface, this is, I think, what makes a difference.
You know, just following that, do you think, you know, giving people options is better, or just leave them, you know, to type whatever they think is relevant to that to the adjustment, and then later on analyze.
You talk about here free from text or drop down list, right?
Yeah,
I think it would be a combination of the two, but I think the evidence that Paul suggests in his book is that the free from text, sometimes they put scripts down that are not understandable from future plans and stuff. So the drop down lists might not be as flexible, but at least they will be more systematic. So I think there are advantages either or. For my case, it would be a combination of, for example, if you have a drop down list and one of the options is promotion, then potentially a second element in the design of the forecast support system could ask about the budget for this promotion.
Mm. Yeah.
So that would be an idea, for example. I'm not sure if this makes sense to you.
No.
But yeah, so essentially, even if you have the same promotion, if you have let's say an advertisement on the TV, one period you spend 10,000, the next period you spend £20,000. That should be somehow recorded in the system as well.
Yeah. Okay, great. I think
cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for it was very helpful.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you so much.
I will just stop